In the last few lectures, we've been talking about the history of cognitive science, particularly the cognitive revolution, those milestone events that occurred in the 20th century by people like Claude Shannon, Alan Turing, Noam Chomsky. In the last lecture, we talked about Alan Turing and his incredible impact on computer science and cognitive science, where he defined what an algorithm might be, how a machine might follow an algorithm. He defined a very simple machine, which turns out to be the basis of all modern computation, the Turing machine. Now we're going to talk about other kinds of computational machinery that might come to bear on human cognition. It turns out the Turing machine is actually more powerful than what we need in order to describe the types of computations that the human mind is capable of. Alan Turing came up with the Turing machine in 1950. And in the next decade, people started to wonder whether you could have simpler kinds of machines with more limited amounts of memory. Remember, the Turing machine has an infinitely long tape, which functionally gives it an infinitely large memory. It's an unbounded memory. And it's the best kind of memory that you can get. You can do anything with it. This is where Noam Chomsky enters the picture. You may have heard of Noam Chomsky. He's a very famous guy. He's a very, very politically active guy. He has a lot to say about American foreign policy. You may have heard of him in that context. But he's also incredibly influential in linguistics and computer science, and of course, in cognitive science. Noam Chomsky is a linguist. He's a syntactician. And in the 1950s, he wrote a book called Syntactic Structures. That book turned out to be the foundational text for modern generative linguistics. He also wrote a really scathing critique of B.F. Skinner's book on how children acquire language called Verbal Behavior. If you ever want to read a really sick burn from the 1950s, it's pretty good. It's pretty savage. Noam Chomsky was interested in computation, but he was really interested in human languages. He wasn't a computer scientist. He was a linguist studying natural human language. But what Chomsky wanted was a more rigorous definition for what a human language might look like. Chomsky wanted to define language in a mathematical way. Instead of just thinking about human beings and the type of languages that we naturally speak and learn, he wanted to give a more rigorous definition of what language could be in the abstract mathematical or logical sense. To do that, he defined formal grammars. And for Chomsky, grammar is a set of rules that generate strings in a language, and a language in the formal sense, a formal language, as opposed to a human language, a formal language is a set of strings over some kind of alphabet, and the alphabet can be anything, any kind of symbols. So formal grammar is going to contain several things. They have a vocabulary of symbols, they have some kind of special start symbol, they have some kind of production rules, and these are the elements that we're going to use to build all of these types of computational machines. So these formal grammars, not only do they describe a certain kind of language that has special computational properties, but they're also used to describe the computational machinery that's used to compute those languages. He wanted to investigate the most restricted possible class of hypothetical languages. So Noam Chomsky thought, let's imagine a language where all the words are just the letter A. So we can imagine a possible word in this language might be something like this. That is a possible word in our language. This is also a possible word in our language. This is also a possible word in our language. These are all possible words in our language. We have created the language where the only thing you can say is, ah! Not a very sophisticated language. It doesn't communicate very much. There's really only one kind of word you can make. It's just any random number of the letter A. Well, why is that interesting? Well, it's not interesting yet, but what we'll see is what kind of computational machinery is required to compute a language like this. For one thing, this requires no memory. So this is much easier than what the Turing machine is normally dealing with. Of course, you could compute this with a Turing machine, because the Turing machine has plenty of memory, but you can also compute it with a much simpler machine, a machine that doesn't have any memory. So maybe a language where you just say, ah, is not very interesting. It's too simple. It requires a computer that has zero memory. That's not super interesting. So maybe let's just go one level above that. What's more complicated than having no memory? Well, maybe you can have a very limited kind of memory. Well, what would that look like? We can imagine a type of memory where you put things into the memory register, but you can only access whatever you put in most recently. This is called a pushdown stack. And one way to conceptualize what this looks like is to imagine maybe putting coins into a coin slot. So I'm putting coins down here, and every one I put down goes on top of the previous one. And so, of course, if I want to pull one out, I have to pull it out from the top. I can't pull one out from down here because it has coins on top of it. The only thing that I have access to is whatever's right on top. Well, what good is that? Well, it turns out this is actually extremely useful, because what you can do is you can do things forwards and backwards. You can have equal numbers of things at the beginning and at the end. Because what this does is it lets you count. It lets you count how many times you've done something and then how many times you should do the opposite thing. So you can use this to make a machine that creates palindromes, words that are the same forward and backward. You can use it to make a language like A to the N, B to the N, a language where you always have an equal number of A's and then an equal number of B's. What about more complicated than that? Well, we can make the memory a little bit more useful by, instead of having a stack, reintroduce the tape from the Turing machine, but then give it a limited window. That's called a linear bounded automaton. It's basically a Turing machine with all of the same construction, but with just a more limited amount of memory, the same type of memory, but a more limited amount of memory. What Noam Chomsky gave us was a way of categorizing different kinds of computations and the complexity of the computational machinery required in order to perform the computations. So we can think about maybe this lowest level, the most inner level of his hierarchy, containing the simplest kinds of computations. This is like the language that's only a bunch of A's down here. These are the finite state languages, the regular languages. These are the languages that can be computed with a finite state machine. If we go one level up, we introduce a new kind of memory. We go from zero memory to some kind of limited memory, the pushdown. This is the context-free region of the hierarchy. And we need a different kind of computational machinery. We need the pushdown stack, that limited memory where you can only access whatever is on the top. We can go up one more level. This is where we introduce a more complex kind of memory, the Turing tape, but with a limited moving window. These are the linear bounded automata. They're used to describe the context sensitive languages. And of course we can draw one more circle above it, and that's where the Turing machine lives. So everything above those three lower levels is considered Turing complete or recursively enumerable. And that's the territory where things have to be computed with a Turing machine. So Noam Chomsky arranged all of these levels, this hierarchy of computation. It's a hierarchy of computational complexity. Chomsky's complexity hierarchy ranges from the most complex possible class of languages, the recursively enumerable languages that require Turing machines, all the way down to the least complex class of languages, the regular languages, that can be computed with finite state machines. So each of these formal languages on each of these rungs of the complexity hierarchy has a certain kind of formal grammar associated with it that generates a certain kind of language, a formal language, and requires a certain kind of computational machinery in order to generate or accept that type of language. And what it gives us is it gives us a way to quantify the complexity of any kind of computation that we might be interested in. Why is this interesting for cognitive science? Well, we can think about specific kinds of computations that are performed by the human mind. Things like language. Language cuts across these areas here. You might think of language as having a fixed complexity, but it turns out language is actually a huge grab bag of different computations. that span several different levels of this hierarchy. They go all the way from the regular region, which require finite state machines that have no memory, all the way possibly into the context-sensitive region that require linear-bounded automata. Something like music, similarly, extends from the finite region, the finite state machines, into pushdown automata, the context-free. It's maybe a little bit controversial whether music goes into the context-sensitive region. These are active research areas that people still debate. How complex can these computations get and still be computable by human beings? If you're interested in animal intelligence, animal cognition, and animal vocalizations also occupies these levels. This is where this becomes a little more controversial. We know that animal communication resides in this regular region, requiring finite state machines with no memory. Maybe it also extends up into that context-free region, which would require some kind of bounded memory. Again, it's still being studied. These are very active research areas, and there's a lot of work being done to try to quantify the complexity of the different sorts of computations that human beings are doing in different contexts, but also animals are doing when they perform their computations. Okay, I want to zero in on the finite state machines and talk about how these might work. How do finite state machines work, and what can they do? They don't have any memory, so it seems kind of odd that they can do anything at all. But actually, finite state machines are actually very, very common in our everyday life. There are lots of machines that exist in our everyday experience that operate according to the logic of finite state machines. And I think one ready example of this is a vending machine. You guys have probably all used a vending machine at some point, right? You want a Snickers bar or a stick of gum or a bag of chips? You go to a vending machine. How do vending machines actually work? You put money into the vending machine and then it gives you some kind of food or whatever, right? Well, we can describe that activity with a finite state machine. So let's suppose we want to buy something from a vending machine for 50 cents, like a stick of gum. Now, how are we going to illustrate this with a finite state machine? Well, a finite state machine always has a starting state, so we'll indicate that here. We got to start somewhere. And what can you do when you go to the finite state machine? What can you do when you're at the vending machine? You can put in a coin. You know that eventually the coins have to add up to 50 cents, but what are your options? Well, I can put in a nickel. What else can I do? I can put in a dime. Maybe 10 cents. Do I have any other options? Well, maybe I can put in a quarter.
Suppose I put a nickel.
I could also put in another nickel. Okay. So that gives me a few options.
That would take me to
put in 5 cents, 10 cents.
State. I would put in 10 cents.
Each of those.
So when I get to this state, the finite state machine actually has no idea how I got here. It has no way of knowing what combination.
When I get to this state, the finite state machine actually has no idea how I got here.
That's part of what we have to do.
Okay, I want to apologize for that. That was a mess. This is what the finite state machine probably should look like. This is a much cleaner version. So you can see there, each state here corresponds to a certain amount of money that has been put into the vending machine. You start at zero, that's the starting state. If you add a nickel, then you get 5 cents. If you add another nickel, you'll get to 10 cents and so on. So each path here is telling you what happens if you put a certain coin into the machine, starting from a certain value. Where will you wind up? How close will you be to actually getting your stick of gum out of the vending machine? So let's try following a few paths and see how this works. Of course, we're always going to start at the zero state. There's no money in the machine. We haven't put any money in yet. So let's start by adding a nickel. Now we're at the 5 cent state. We've added 5 cents. If we add another nickel, we'll go to 10 cents. One more nickel gets us to 15 cents. And of course, we can add another nickel to get to 20 cents, and another nickel to get to 25 cents, and then we get our stick of gum. But of course, there's many, many other ways that we can get to 25 cents. We can start at zero and input a dime. That'll take us to 10 cents. Then maybe we can input a nickel to get to 15, then another dime to get to 25. Or maybe we'll skip all of these steps and just put in a quarter and get directly to 25 cents in one go. The point is that the machine doesn't have any memory. It doesn't know how you got to each of these states. It only knows how much money is currently in the machine. It doesn't know what path you took to get there. So really what the finite state machine is a way of showing you what are all of the possible paths that you can take to get to a certain output without having any memory of how you actually got there. So you can do some fairly complex calculations without requiring any memory whatsoever. So if you think about the output that this finite state machine is generating, right? Essentially, it tells you what a legal combination of coins will be that will get you your stick of gum. The finite state machine tells you, like, okay, if you want a stick of gum, you can give me 2 quarters, or you can give me 1 quarter, 1 nickel, and 2 dimes, or you can give me 1 quarter and 5 nickels, etc., etc., right? It's just listing basically all of those valid possible combinations of coins, and it's giving you a path that will get you to that output state. So essentially what the finite state machine is showing you is it's showing you a map of how to get from 0 coins to a stick of gum in a vending machine. It's a really simple machine. It doesn't know a lot. But that's the output of the finite state machine, legal combinations of coins. You can maybe think of those as like legal sentences or legal strings, right? We often think of strings when we talk about finite state machines. But the machine has no memory. It doesn't know how you got there. It doesn't know how you got to that endpoint. It just knows that you got there. Very, very simple piece of machinery. Okay, so let's walk through a couple examples of some finite state machines. I'll just draw it up here and then we'll see what it does. So let's start with this machine. It's got a starting state, and then it's got another state where we're going to output an A, and then it's got another state where we're going to output a B, and that will be our ending state. We'll mark that with a double circle. So what kinds of things does this finite state machine generate? What are the valid or legal sentences or strings that it will generate? Well, you can just follow the path. You have to start here, and then when you get here, you have to go here. There's only one option, and then you have to go there. There's only one option. So actually, this finite state machine is really simple. It only generates one thing. It generates A, B. That is the only sentence that this finite state machine knows. This is probably too simple to be useful for anything. Okay, well, let's look at a finite state machine that looks even simpler than this. We've only got one state, and we've only got one transition, and it loops back on itself, and all it does is generate A. What is this going to generate? Well, we can get A. Oh, I forgot to mark. This is also the ending state. It is both the starting state and the ending state. We can generate A. We can generate AA. We can generate AAA. We can generate AAA. What is this? This is Noam Chomsky's language. It just generates infinite A's. Okay, well, that's not super interesting either, but it does something anyways, and you can generate infinitely long strings with this. It has an infinite generative capacity. It only generates one kind of string, but it can generate an infinitely long version of that one string. Well, let's suppose we add something to this. We take the same basic structure. We have a loop. I'll put it over here. Here's our A loop. But then we got something else over here. This is our ending state now. Well, we've got that loop where we can generate as many A's as we want, right? A, A, A. But then if we want to end, we have to go to the ending state. And to get to the ending state, you have to output a B. So at some point, you're going to have a B. So this is just a language that's just the language plus a B. It's any number of A's is acceptable as long as you also have a B at the end. All right, what about a language that looks like this? Here our starting state is our ending state again. We've got one transition, it goes to a state over here where it generates an A, and then we loop back and generate a B. So what can we generate with this finite state machine? Well, we gotta start here. We can also end here. So we could actually generate nothing. That's acceptable. That's allowable. If you wanna generate something, well, you're gonna have to follow this path. It's the only option. It's the only path out of that first state. So you generate an A. Can you end here? No. Got to go back, so you got to generate a B, and then you can end. You don't have to end. You can keep going if you want, so you can generate AB, but you can also do AB, A, B. You can generate any number of sequence of A, B sequences. Any number of A, B pairs that you want. So this is nice. It's a little finite state machine that sort of loops back on itself. Okay. There's a lot we can do with finite state machines, and it can describe the behavior of lots of very simple machines like vending machines or the locker. If you go to a water park, you've got to put like your keys and your dry clothes and your shoes into a locker, right? And that also works with a finite state machine. There are lots of really simple machines that work this way. Okay, but what does that have to do with human beings and human thought and cognition? Because I'm not really interested in water park lockers as a cognitive scientist. I want to know how human minds work. What else can we do with this thing? Well, one really common use for the finite state machine is rules for what is a valid variable name in programming languages. In most programming languages, any combination of letters or digits can constitute a variable name, but it must start with a letter. So you can have a sequence of letters like my name, like RYAN, that's a valid variable name. You have K9, but you couldn't have 9K. That's actually really simple to model with a finite state machine. You just have to start with the first transition being a letter, and then after that you can have anything you want. Okay, that's about computers. What about human beings? Well, it turns out finite state machines actually do describe something very interesting about the way that we think, certain kind of computation that we do. It describes what constitutes a valid word in human languages. So of all human languages we've ever surveyed, the one thing that they all have in common is that the rules for how to make a valid word, what sequence of sounds and what order will make a valid word, is always describable with finite state machines. We've never found a language yet that has more complex rules than what you could model with a finite state machine, at least for generating valid words, valid sequences of sounds. So this incredibly simple machine with no memory turns out to be an incredibly useful thing that describes mental computations that we are actually performing all the time. And I can give an example of this. Let's take words in English that start with P. Well, a word in English that starts with P. I can think of words in English that start with P that go P-L vowel, like play. I can also think of words in English that go P-R vowel, like pray. And I can also think of words that go P and then the vowel directly, like pay. That's a very, very simple kind of rule. That's just telling you what sequence of sounds you can have in what order. And you can describe that with a finite state machine. And so it just turns out that all of the rules that we've ever seen about how to do this, how to put letters or sounds in a certain sequence to generate words for human languages, they all can be described in this way by these kinds of machines. It also applies even to certain kinds of sentences. So you take a sentence like, the cat chased the rat that ate the cheese that fell under the fridge, da-da-da-da-da, right? And children play this game, the house that Jack built, right? You can add as many layers to that as you want. It turns out that that structure can be generated by a finite state machine. You can create a very simple finite state machine that just generates a subject and then a verb, and then a subject and a verb, and a subject and a verb, and it can go forever and ever. It just loops back on itself. Essentially what that is it's this finite state machine that generates sequences of AB. This finite state machine, the AB loop, actually describes a very common type of sentence in many languages, including English. So there are lots of things in language that can be described with these machines. But not everything in language can be described with these machines. We do have some structures that are more complex, that require more memory than these machines, than finite state machines. What kind of structures are those? What are those going to look like? Well, if we jump up a level in the hierarchy, we wind up in the context-free languages. Languages that require push-down automata. They require that kind of bounded memory. The memory where you can only access what's on top. What is that useful for in language? Well, it turns out that there are structures in languages, including English, that require this amount of memory. You cannot describe them with finite state machines. So an example of this would be a sentence like, the rat the cat chased ate the cheese. It has a slightly different structure than the one we said earlier, the cat chased the rat that ate the cheese. Now, we say the rat the cat chased ate the cheese. Linguists call these center-embedded sentences. You're essentially putting a sentence inside the middle of another sentence. And in order to do that, you need to have some kind of memory. Turns out you cannot model this, at least not in a full productive capacity, with a finite state machine. It requires at least a very limited kind of memory. It requires pushdown. You can also use pushdown automata to describe other kinds of things like well-formed parentheses in mathematics or in programming. So if you have a left parentheses, you also have to have a right parentheses, right? You have to match one to one. So that's what pushdown is good for. It's good for matching an equal number of something with an equal number of something else. With parentheses, you got to match every left parenthesis with a right parenthesis. In language, if you say something like the rat the cat chased, you have to match every subject with a verb. And since they're on opposite ends of the sentence, you get this nested structure that requires memory, requires pushdown. So what did Chomsky give us? Chomsky gave us this beautiful hierarchy of computational complexity. That gives us the tools we need to quantify the complexity of specific computations that are being undertaken by the mind. And this, I think, is huge. This had a huge impact on computer science. Computer scientists still use this hierarchy very often. There was a lot of work done with this hierarchy in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. But it's cycling back, and we're bringing it back into linguistics. There's even research being done at Rutgers by Adam Jardine, where we're taking that complexity hierarchy, applying it to human languages to see how we can describe the types of computations that humans are doing based on the patterns that we see in human language. And I think that that's just enormous for cognitive science, to be able to quantify the types of computations that we are doing, to be able to quantify thought, to quantify cognition. To me, that's tremendous. So I just want to review some key concepts from today. We talked about the Chomsky hierarchy, a complexity hierarchy that we can use to quantify the complexity of different kinds of computations and the machinery required to compute them. And we talked specifically about finite state machines, finite state automata, and pushdown automata, two types of machinery that describe those two lowest levels of the hierarchy. The finite state machines having zero memory, no memory whatsoever, and pushdown having a very limited kind of memory. Turns out that these are the two most important types of machinery for describing different aspects of human cognition. A lot of what we do as humans can be described at these two levels of complexity using these different types of computational machines.